Okay, I'm going to call the work session of October 13th, 2015 to order. Now's an opportunity for citizens to make comments on items that are not on the agenda. If anyone wants to speak to this body, please come forward now. I see no one approaching, and I don't think Mr. Martin is coming for a comment. He's going to sit down. So we'll move on then. Item number one, consideration of event permit for Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation on October 31st. Any questions about that one? Or the next one, Turkey Trot 5K, Grace Works Ministry on November 26th. Okay, number three, retail liquor license application for Brinkman's Wine and Spirits, Sarati Retail Investments, Rushank Ramesh Sarati. Any questions about that one? Number four is presentation of McEwen Interchange Landscape Enhancement Project, an estimated cost of $36,594.19.
As our Parks Director, Lisa Clayton, and Streets Director, Joe York are coming up. I don't know if we have some other folks joining us.
Oh, yeah. So we have a whole crew for you. One of the things we try to look at is our gateways in the community, where people enter and exit our community and recognize that our impressions that we make as people enter our community are important. And one of those key areas is the intersection at McEwen and I-65. There's a nice monument there, but there's not a whole lot else. And so our own staff has taken a look at this and the opportunity to improve the landscaping and do it at a fairly affordable rate with our own crews performing the work and then the following maintenance after the work is conducted. So our parks team, our streets team have worked together. I think Brian Walker sort of took the lead in doing the design, and I'll let them walk you through what we're looking at and then have a little discussion, and then I'll talk to you a little more about how we would like to move forward if you're comfortable. So, Lisa,
go ahead. Just first of all, I'll introduce, and then I'll let Joe introduce his team member. But Brian Walker, of course, is our grounds and landscaping foreman within the Parks Department. And Todd Snackenberg is our city arborist that was part of this project. And Joe?
And also Jerry Garrett, who is our landscape maintenance supervisor.
Jerry and, just joined us about, what, 6-7 months ago?
90 days.
Did it feel like 6 months? Well, we've gotten 6 months of work out of Jerry in the last 90 days.
That sounds like a sentence, didn't it? 90 days.
But I'd just like to thank Brian Walker, who designed this, put all this together, and he working with Jerry and Todd and putting this together. And Brian, if you want to just walk them through it, appreciate it.
Sure, be happy to. First off, what we're looking at is the McEwen Interchange. The way it is designed, it's broken down into six different areas. One area was considered the northeast quadrant, the southwest quadrant, and then again on the northwest and southwest, and then the medians. With the way when we were and Joe approached us about it, some of the ideas were is that some of the concerns with citizens was that the intersection wasn't as attractive as they'd like it to be, and so what we've come up with is a what I feel is a fairly low maintenance landscape plan. We tried to have as much color brought into it as much as we could, and then also to have a rather low maintenance design as well. And with that, what we have is a selection of various plant materials, perennials, evergreen shrubs. There'll be some additional trees, and also there'll be a turf, a buffer that will go around that perimeter. One of the interesting things is that with the marquee signs that are there, the plantings will basically replicate themselves or mirror each other. Where the two marquee signs are, those plantings will be similar to each other. And then the other quadrant, the northeast and the southwest, will have a similar plant design, and then the two medians will be similar as well. As far as the medians are concerned, there isn't any turf in that area, and because there was, what I wanted to do there is because of the intersection that is so close is to, if we have a single planting bed there, that would push and not have any turf, then that way we wouldn't have to have streets department guys close to the intersection to get them as far away from that intersection as possible. This design here is the southwest and the south and the northeast design would be similar to that. Again, there's basically it's crepe myrtles, perennials, ornamental grasses, some trees, and then some flowering shrubs would be in that area. Again, this would be the same thing here. Part of this design, or with the guidelines that we came from, go hand in hand with the TDOT guidelines for intersections. That's what we use to help guide me in this process. And I feel that we've achieved that, and we have spoken to TDOT already, and we've gotten their blessing with the design itself. And that's a breakdown with the total being at 36,000. We also went ahead and broke it down into phases in the sections. So if we chose to, we could do it step by step instead of doing it all at once. But that's I guess what we're here for, is for y'all to take a look at that and decide if that's how we want to proceed with that.
So we can deliver this, we believe, for about $36,000 with our crews performing the work. Joe and Jerry are comfortable that we have the crews to do it. Todd can help us with the tree plantings as well, and believe that this will really upgrade what you see when you come off of that key intersection in our community. In terms of funding, we would look for that funding to come from the hotel motel tax, and we'll look to amend that the next cycle that we do budget amendments. As you'll remember, we did not budget the full capacity in that fund. So there are dollars available. This is a relatively small amount. The trees can be funded through the tree bank funds. So the other plantings we would do through hotel motel, and again, our staff would work this into their work plan for the balance of this year, and may lead into the spring as well in terms of the plantings. What we would like to do, if you're comfortable, is to proceed with the project. We have a key planting time right now, window that we'd like to start moving on. If you're comfortable knowing that the budget amendment will come, there's sufficient capacity in the fund now, but we would ultimately need to make an amendment sometime down the line, and then get the project moving while we have this window to do the plantings.
I see no additional staff is needed. No. To do this work. I mean, most of the maintenance over the course of the next year.
Yes, Jerry will work that into his schedule with his landscape crew. And right now is a perfect opportunity for us to do this. We're winding up the mowing season, and it's a perfect opportunity to start this.
What kind of trees again?
Craigmore was one of them.
Well, some of the trees, we have existing trees out there from an earlier planting that are some understory trees, some lower growing trees. Excuse me, the trees that we're going to plant are all fastigiate or columnar trees, so they'll grow tall, but they won't have wide spreading branches out into traffic, and we're doing that for sight distance, and we'll also keep an eye on them. Any necessary pruning that we need to do on a yearly or semi-yearly basis will be performed in-house.
Because I know that let's just say that you're making a right-hand turn off of 65 heading west, that's not even a 90 degree turn that you've got to look. It's even more so than that you've got to turn back around to see. So I just want to make sure we weren't getting anything there that was going to obstruct the view there, because it's difficult enough to turn to look back over your shoulder, not just 90 degrees.
Yeah, we've been out there multiple times. Okay. And have looked at where, right, you know, the best planting areas would be, and then of course choosing the species of trees that'll work there without affecting that sight distance at all.
Yeah. Alderman Skinner?
I know once these get established, as long as we don't get into drought conditions, this should be okay.
Correct. The plants that were chosen have a certain level of drought tolerance. A lot of the plant material came from TDOT's list of plant material, and so that was something we definitely considered.
So we're not looking at additional staff to have to water until they get established, because there's no water out there.
Correct.
And we have to do that.
Correct. Yes.
So Joe,
we're very comfortable with that. We can work that.
Alderman Peterson.
I did have a question also about low maintenance, you know, and I'm sure to get things started off, you are going to have to water. But after that, we would be expecting it to just kind of be seasonal, whatever, to go with whatever the season is, right?
Yes, ma'am.
That was good to hear. The other thing that I wondered about was, is that like every year, a lot of this stuff just comes back. You know what I mean? Right. Because sometimes even TDOT has, over the years, has planted some stuff and it had to be seen about every year, you know, or it died. But it looked to me as if your choices, from what I know, would just continue to, and like the coneflower and stuff like that. A lot of this is native, I mean, you know, and so, and I don't know about some of the rest of it.
Yeah, it's up there. Like I said, the flowers that are out there are perennials, and they are by nature will come back year after year. And then with the evergreens and the more of your hardy shrubs, they'll come back year after year.
Yeah, but they have blooms on them too, which I like. But you know, hey
there's
no
out there.
No water there.
Alderman right. Burger.
That's a little other subject. I think, Joe, we took those plants, that tree down, when you drive off the interstate, if you're going south, you drive off. Remember, we had the nice marquee up there and said, welcome to Franklin, historic Franklin, and nobody could ever see it because we put a tree right in front of it, you know, so we got that out of there. So those, and I'm sorry, I had to run out and get something to somebody, so I don't know if I missed anything in the front, but those big bowls that are sitting in front of the, that are sort of useless. Is there a way to get rid of those, or you're going to use them at all?
As far from a planting standpoint, no. They're not deep enough to really hold any sort of soil.
They just serve no purpose. I say we get rid of them because they look weird. Because people drive up and they're expecting to see a plant in there. It's a planter, and this planter never holds anything. I say we look and repurpose them someplace else, and look at that, because it just, they don't fit. They don't go there because you can't do anything with them. And if they were planted or if they were built there to really use, that would be one thing. So I think we need to look at getting rid of those. And the other thing is, so none of the marquee area on that stone will be inhibited in any way.
No. All the plant material would be well below the lettering on the marquee.
I'm sure you did that. Okay, because this is really important, because this is a huge gateway to everything that's happening on the east side, and I appreciate this. The medians, is there a way eventually, well, let me get to that in a minute. We're going down just to Franklin Park's entrance, correct? Or we don't go down quite that far?
From the intersection, it goes back to where the stoplights are, the red lights are. It goes back that far, which is, I think, around 260 feet.
Okay, so that's not very far. It's just right there. Okay. How about, you know, we'll have to work in maintenance money through the years on this, but have we ever looked into drilling out there for well water?
We have not, no.
Okay. That's something I'd like us to do eventually, but I would like us to get with Pat Emery, because they're going to be doing a plan for the entrance there at Franklin Park, so they're going to have to go up to where we stop and then come down to Carruthers and then all of Carruthers from Liberty back up to Cool Springs. They're going to try to incorporate that. I've just talked to him recently, had a meeting with him on that, and then Eric and I talked, so I've mentioned that to him, what we're all going to look at doing for the intersection. So maybe we can partner with them in some way, shape, or form to look for water in that area. Now, I don't know if there is water in that area, and I don't know if they've looked at that, but I think we need to do something on that. So I'll get back with you on that after I talk to them, but if you can just, you know, check out anything that you might have on that. The other thing is the medians. Can you tell me about the, whoops, wait a minute. It's the fragrant sumac. Is that the same stuff that we have now in the median up on Carruthers? Do you know?
I'm not sure about that. As far as the plant itself, it'll grow to around 24 to 30 inches high. It has about a 3 to 4 foot wide spread. It has from its name, it has a bit of a sweet smell to it. So that's the best way to describe that plant.
Okay, I don't know what they've got up there. I know what they have on Carruthers there by the Marriott. If you go from Cool Springs, like you're headed towards Baker's Bridge, they have some really hardy material in their medians. So just take a look and see what they've got compared to what you have down here. I'm not saying don't use this. I'm just saying take a look, because it seems to stay pretty hardy, and I'm just looking for maintenance, you know, for you all for maintenance. So if you just take a look at that, and the drilling was the other thing. So that's it. That's all I had. Thanks so much.
Everybody feel positive about having drought-resistant, low-maintenance design landscaping. Mm-hmm. Thanks
Excellent
a lot.
Design. Good job. Good job.
And pretty inexpensive, don't you think?
Yeah, yes. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you.
Great in-house.
Another example of the talent.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to go on to number five, consideration resolution number 2015-81, entitled resolution to approve a pilot payment in lieu of taxes program for the Lampo Group Incorporated as requested by the Industrial Development Board of Williamson County, Tennessee.
Mayor and Alderman, this is on for vote tonight as well. This is an economic incentive opportunity for additional investment of an existing company in Franklin as they grow and expand to build their campus down in Berry Farms on the Reams-Fleming tract on the southernmost portion. And so as we look at these projects from time to time, there's an opportunity to work with the development and help it happen. The county has moved forward with a similar tax abatement. Of course, their property tax base and their property tax rate is significantly larger than ours, but we have matched one another, at least is what is proposed in terms of providing an abatement of between 41 and 42% of the property taxes paid over there are two different phases anticipated, both around a 10-year duration and capped at a certain dollar amount, $360,000 in the first phase, and then the second phase has some allowance for inflation, so that could reach as high as a little over $400,000 collectively over its 10-year period as well. But one of the things we show is the taxes generated are still larger than what you would be abating, and helps lead to the potential of up to almost 800 new jobs in the community and the expansion and additional investment by an existing company that does a lot of great work both here and across the country. The Lampo Group, of course, was founded by Dave Ramsey, who's pretty well known both here and across the country. And we're excited to move it forward. It has received its approval as of last night from the County Commission and is in front of you for consideration. We have representatives from the company here with us tonight. If you have any questions for them, invite them to come up if they would like, and we'll be glad to field questions that you may have and allow them to say anything they'd like about their investment. And introduce themselves when it's Tom and Elizabeth from the Chamber.
What happens if they don't have a seat? What happens if they don't fulfill their 398 new jobs or 400 new jobs? You do the abatement based upon the fact that they're saying they're going to have 400 new jobs. The economic impact to the area is twice as good as what it currently is. What happens if that doesn't? The abatement still goes on.
Well, you have the ability to claw back is the terminology if targets are not met. In terms of the minimum
and we have added that to the agreement.
Yeah, in terms of the minimum of investment and job creation, those are both elements that a clawback can be based on. Okay. And we've in recent years added that as a component to these abatement agreements.
If I may.
Go ahead, Tom.
I'm Tom Trent. I'm an attorney that worked on this. And this has a built-in performance criteria. And the county started doing that recently on a few deals where it adjusts every year. They have to report the number of jobs they've created. if they don't hit 80% of the target, which is the same as the state's requirement, so that matches, then there's a proportionate reduction in the abatement every year. So it just takes care of itself with the formula. And that's what the state's now doing with their accountability agreement on their grant side. And so a lot of communities have adopted the 80% rule, and it works out nicely because then the company's got to meet that and everybody's, it automatically adjusts.
So you only need the county's approval, the city's approval?
And the IDBs.
The IDBs already know.
Those have all been granted, yes, sir.
We're in the last.
You get to be
the last one.
And let's make sure everybody knows who everybody is. Of course, Elizabeth West, go ahead and...
Yep, sure. Elizabeth West McCrary, I'm VP of Economic Development for Williamson County.
And I'm Tom Trent, I'm a Bradley Abraham Bolt Cummings, and I'm counsel to the Lampo Group for this.
And I'm Winston Cruz, and I'll be the project manager on this development.
See, I'm glad you introduced, because I thought you were Dave Ramsey. Doesn't look different on radio.
Your voice is different.
Pass that along.
Sure, I'll take that and pass it along. Yep.
All right, now, are we talking about the development?
Sure.
The building that you're talking about in Berry Farms? Is that what we're talking about?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
What you're talking about is the development incentive specifically.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. And then we're going to talk about the height and all of that.
All of that is consistent with the previously approved plans for Berry Farms and for the Reams Fleming track in particular. So the board has already approved development plans essentially for this area, and this is consistent with that in terms of building height and the character of the buildings and the development itself. So that's been worked through with staff and is consistent with previous approvals granted by the city.
Mm-hmm. Alderman Skinner.
I know when we did our planning tour that Bob Martin took us on, there was some discussion about road infrastructure through there. Mm-hmm. Have we negotiated more cost sharing about infrastructure, particularly roads?
Yeah, we have, and Winston may want to speak to it too, but it's been really a three-party discussion around how we work through that. The city is committed to replace a bridge on Pratt Lane that is in need of it, and so we will make that investment. That's about a $400,000 to $500,000 investment. Both Lampo Group and Boyle Development have committed to provide additional right-of-way needed for the ultimate expansion or improvement of that road and to do some grading associated with that. That will be done at the time it's determined that it's appropriate to be done by the city in terms of the full road improvements. In the meantime, the primary access to Lampo's site will be through a spine road, again, part of the development that Boyle will put in place with the construction of the first building and the first parts of this campus construction. So that will be the primary entrance. The entrances off of Pratt Lane will be for emergency access only. And as that road is improved, as other development warrants it, then we may be able to open up further access, but we'll need the road improvements first, and we're getting the right of way and anticipating some of the other work ahead of that as well. Winston, did I hit that?
That's it.
So that's impressed. Really Boyle and Lampo and the city all kind of getting on the same page about what each of us do to make those improvements possible.
Would it be helpful for him to walk you through the map?
Yeah. Sure, because I had a particular question about the underpass here.
Sure. Yeah, okay. Of course, the top page is the master plan of all of Berry Farms. So we're talking about the Reams Fleming tract on the right-hand side. And specifically the southernmost portion, there's 45 acres that are under contract right now. So the second page actually is a zoom in of that southern portion. And for tonight's purposes, lot one and lot two would be phase one and phase two. Those are the first two building sites. And you can see the spine road that will actually run to the northern boundary that will connect with Boyle Spine Road as well. The two, three access points on Pratt Lane are the emergency accesses that Mr. Stuckey referenced. The next couple of pages get into a little bit of the hiring history and hiring projections for the Lampo Group. And most of these are based on a huge demand for technology hires. Lampo Group officially hired their 507th team member recently, and as they merge from an analog company, books, DVDs, radio, into a more digital space to participate and be competitive there, we've actually been given the tall task of hiring technology positions. So this would include front-end developers, architects, systems, and IT, governance, and there's a huge demand for that. The you can actually see those breakdowns by department and by position, the average salary within those positions, which is where we came up with the 398 hires for the contract. Very last page shows the initial investment for the land in phase one.
So phase one is around $58 million. Phase two, I believe, is around $40
million.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So you get to a collective investment, just about $98 million. And Winston walked you through the significant job growth in addition. One of the things we know is that 70-plus percent of our job growth comes from existing businesses. And this is a great example of that, too, where existing businesses grow, flourish, and invest even more in the community. And that's a big part of why we're here tonight to talk about this and why we're advancing it and recommending it to the board.
We do vote on this tonight.
Yes.
Now, my question was centered around the salary range, and I think you sort of, this is here. So we have a lot of people, you know, kind of in that mid to high 50 for this group, mm-hmm. this number of people mm-hmm. that will be working at this place. Mm-hmm. And just always like to be able to see if these people can afford to live here and where right. would they live, mm-hmm. making this kind of money.
Right.
And we have some great salaries on here, and we also have some beginner salaries.
Right.
So. Sure. Just want to make that public.
I do think it's important to note they're currently in four different buildings here in Franklin.
Yeah.
They had an opportunity. They were looking at what this growth should look like moving forward. They were looking at other communities for that growth. I think one of the things that they looked at was where their employees come from at this point. Where are they driving in from? And so that's part of the reason Berry Farms was such an attractive site for them. Their employees will be able to drive in from different areas. But we also looked at this and thought that those salary ranges are actually really good.
Yeah.
Those are some strong paying positions. There's a lot of tech jobs here. And we do believe that this is the exact kind of corporate citizen that we need to be supporting.
Mm-hmm. Other questions, comments?
So this would replace the other four buildings that are currently?
They will actually still maintain those other locations. This would, I think, eventually maybe replace them.
Sure. So two of those four are leased and two of them are owned. We have every intention to retain the one that is owned, which is the mm-hmm. Financial Peace Building that's Cracker Barrel on Mallory Lane, which is in Brentwood currently. So that's what
we'll hold that against you.
Thank you. That's what we intend to do. But
you said, where is that?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. So but we believe that, you know, business moves at the speed of trust and communication, and everybody's spread out right now, and it's our attempt to get everybody back under the same roof.
Right.
And that's what we decided to do a couple of years ago when we first started looking.
I think so it's great for our community.
The development would start actually on the very south end of the Reams property. Mm-hmm. So Boyle's gonna build the road all the way from?
It'll be north of the intersection of Paytonsville and Pratt Lane is what they're required to do.
Okay. And the other phase where this underpass is shown would be with Boyle at all.
That's not part of this development. Yeah, that's okay. That's part of the other elements of Reams Plumbing.
Everybody good?
Yep.
I just am glad to be able to assist our businesses that are here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Because I know the Chamber's really reached out, and Jeremiah and you all and Matt have done a good job of trying to key into our existing businesses, because a lot of times we put that emphasis on the new businesses. And I've read over this agreement. It looked pretty good. and I think it's fair, and I think you'll bring a lot to the area, and I appreciate you all staying in the community.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you for your time.
Great comments. Thanks, Wes.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Okay, item number six is consideration ordinance 2015-50 to be entitled an ordinance to rezone 7.43 acres from a state residential to residential R3 district for properties located at 1034 and 1040 Carlisle Lane. Wow, y'all look great tonight.
Everybody looks so nice.
Who's got this one?
This one would be mine. The ordinance before you is for Carlisle Lane, a PUD subdivision near the intersection of Carlisle Lane and Old Charlotte Pike, 20 units on 7.43 acres. The FMPC motion was to disapprove.
Let me ask Vernon and Paul to also touch on this, that there's some real important implications regarding infrastructure on this project, and I think is the basis for the disapproval, and give Vernon and Paul a chance to talk a little bit about
it. And we'll also be covering this, we'll be talking about number seven also.
Six and seven.
Right.
So not cause the rezoning ones, the development plan.
Right. Thank you, and good evening. What Paul and I would briefly like to share with you is a situation that we see continuing to come up in our community as our city expands out towards the perimeter of our corporate limits. And the situation is this, is that in this case, and Vicki just put up Carlisle Lane, is that in this instance, the developer, Mr. Mells, is proposing to rezone his property in accordance with our land use plan and change that rezoning that would allow for the building of 20 residential units. But we've reached a point in this particular area and on Carlisle Lane that road needs to be improved. It is an inadequate rural type of road. Now, we've talked with Greg Gamble, his design professional, and Mr. Mells, and appreciate them keep proceeding with this application to allow us to highlight this concern. And the concern is that before this and any further development that creates more intensity than it's the property's current zone, the road needs to be improved. And we don't have a mechanism currently to improve a collector road of this nature. As you are aware, our road impact fees are used only for increasing a capacity of arterial roadways. So what we have to do is not allow this development to improve until such time that road is brought up to current standards. And in accordance with our current standards, that would include curb and gutter and stormwater infrastructure, which Paul can show and is shown on the screen, approaches over $2 million. Now, we don't have a solution for you except this, is that we want to come back in the near future to share some ideas. One idea that we talked about approximately a year ago when we upgraded the road impact fee study was to include collector roads in the fee structure of the road impact fee ordinance. And as a coincidence, Mr. Mells has submitted a letter saying he'd be happy to pay that additional fee for collectors if he could be allowed to proceed. But obviously, even that payment of that additional $66,800 as it relates to his property is a very, very small portion to improve the road. So thereby, that type of model, if applied universally across the city, is one option. Additionally, we also, under the current development process, we require developers to make improvement to collector roads that are impacted by the intensity and the density of their development that they're creating. That is not an equitable
type of process, because in some cases, a developer may be required to make a greater investment, whereas another developer, not quite of the same type of investment. It's just based on a current situation and the roadways that are needed to be improved. Paul and I continue to look at different options and keep coming back that the road impact fee structure that includes collector roads seems to be the most equitable. But we're not here today to have that discussion. We simply want, I want to let Paul share the safety concerns associated with Carlisle Lane that lead us to recommending disapproval to this of this development, but also do want to recognize the applicant has complied with our land use plan and the development of his 7.5 acres, but we can't recommend approval because the road needs to be improved. Paul?
Yeah, first I'd like to start off by saying that the applicant with the development plan, Mr. Mills and Greg, have put together an awesome plan. I mean, it really works well with the surrounding properties. The neighbors seem to support it based on the Planning Commission meeting. And what we did is, in admittedly, at the pre-application meeting, that's when we have these discussions first. And we told them from the beginning, right up front, that we have issues with this roadway and safety concerns associated with it. And I'll say that there are two developments, Blossom Park, there was another 4-lot subdivision that happened on this roadway that went through with no comments other than dedicate that future right-of-way. And so at what point do we stop allowing development to occur in this area is just kind of a judgment call, and there are some engineering considerations that go into it. And at the pre-application meeting was when we told them that unless we could resolve these off-site infrastructure issues, we were going to recommend disapproval of the rezoning and that it should develop out at its current zoning at a much less dense rate, which is about 3 units an acre. And so, Vicki, if you'll go to the next slide, please. The estimated cost of the improvements is around $2.1 million to do Carlisle Lane, which is way more than the development can afford to pay, and it's not fair for them to have that burden put on their shoulders. This shows the other two developments that were approved. Their requirements were to dedicate right away. We indicated that to them up front, that if we could go back on those and reconsider those, we'd probably be having this discussion with them, but we were trying to facilitate development with those. And if you go to the last slide, Vicki, the last slide shows all your collector roads in purple and green. And what you'll notice is that west of Hillsborough Road and north of MacHatcher, there are 12.5 miles of collector roadways. Right now, today, we have no funding source to be able to do that other than the general fund, or it's to be funded by development as development occurs. And so how do you proportionately spread that out amongst the multiple developments that may occur out there? And as Vernon stated, the fairest way that we've come up with to date is to implement the collector impact fee. And so we'd like to come back and have that discussion with you today or at a later date. And so with that said, we're happy to answer any questions that you may have.
And I do, okay. Could I say something about the Planning Commission? The comments that are made is the reason that the Planning Commission recommended disapproval. I guess I could say what others have said, it really wasn't the project itself. Yeah. But I didn't want to make that clear, even though there was a definite vote to recommend disapproval, but it was really for the reasons that we're talking about here.
Vice Mayor.
Thank you.
Whether this development is approved or not, isn't the road just as dangerous now, today?
It is, but I guess it's our opinion that we didn't want to start adding more density, more residents, to really have to commit the board to making this improvement. A commitment that I'm not sure that we've identified in the capital plan in the near future, and from what I've heard, that it's nowhere near, and that was the reason for the recommendation.
Here's my take on some of this. I find it almost unbelievable that 600 or 700 yards of road is $2.1 million. We've discussed the straightening out of those curves. The road is just as dangerous today as it was yesterday or tomorrow or the next day. Now, to say that we need curb gutters, that's okay. I mean, I don't mind saying that, but I would say to you that I think that we probably need to go out there and look at that road without as economically as we can look at it. Now, we spent $1.8 million on the intersection there. did a tremendous job on that, and I think that helped both Boyd, let's see, yeah, be would be Boyd Mill and Carlisle and 96. But you've got very, very, and the curve that's with the rock wall and the tree sticking out, I guess it would be Blossom Park. That is, that you, there's no way you can see around that curve. I'm surprised we haven't had more wrecks than we've had there. I would encourage you, and I don't think that a 20-house development is going to be able to fund a $2 million road improvement. I would prefer to have, whether we agree or disagree with the road with the development, the road needs to be looked at, to be straightened out, to be improved from a safety standpoint, and that doesn't necessarily drop on any one particular developer like it is on this one right here. We approved Blossom Park, we approved the other one. I guess there's only four houses in the other one, then the triangle thing there. Mm-hmm. So, and this is a 20-unit development? Mm-hmm. Okay. That's my personal take on it. I can't believe that it is $2.1 million to go out there and straighten out a couple of curves and widen some pavement or whatever it takes to make it a little bit safer road than what's out there right now. So I would encourage you to look at it from that standpoint. If he's willing to contribute an additional $66,000 or whatever it is to that, look at it. Now, I'm only 1/8 of the board, and so there may be 7/8 of the board that wants curb, gutters, sidewalks, a utility trail, side, you know, whatever else we can throw on that thing. But that's a dangerous, that road, that particular section, those two curves are very dangerous.
Alderman Skinner?
If we decide to go with revisiting our road impact fees, how long would that process take if we decided to vote for collector roads to be included?
Well, we would want to come back and have an engaged conversation about that, because when we would implement that, the likelihood is that we would district off the areas that in the city to apply those fees that come in for collector roads.
Okay.
That's again, the road impact fee model is one option. We want to try to take a look at another option so you have choices. What Alderman Barnhill brought up in looking at Carlisle Lane is valid. The purpose, as Paul and I are being here, is that this isn't the last time we're going to be having this discussion as our development keeps to move out towards the edge of our corporate limits and into our urban growth boundary. We have an annexation on the agenda this evening that talks that is accessed through county roads. Mm-hmm. And we're going to engage the county and look very critically at that infrastructure, but it's the same type of discussion as we grow our community.
And I may be more dwelling on one specific,
right,
and you may be more looking at this specific to have future decisions made. Yeah. So
I want to emphasize a point here, is that when we have a discussion with a developer, and you may recall a little bit more than a year ago when the Pulte group came in with a proposed Del Webb development, and they were looking at property that included hundreds of acres. Mm-hmm. The capacity and density afforded to a development of that size allows them to make an investment of significance, mm-hmm, that could improve a lot of rural type roadways. However, this is an example, and Mr. Mells has two parcels that total 7.5 acres, that there's not much that can be expected. And as we grow and there's a lot of smaller parcels, what is the most equitable way to obtain some type of resources that can go towards those improvements? Otherwise, you compete against the other the funds and the projects, the numerous projects that are in our capital improvement plan.
So again, if we decided to go with a variety of these directions, is there any estimate of how soon?
Well, we'd probably, we hope to come back here in the next several months, shortly after the first of the year, ask the consultant to look again at what they've given us, and then look at a couple other options.
So would it require the consultant to do additional study?
Yeah, we would need the consultant to look at a few different options, and then you probably want to have multiple work sessions and a public meeting. So I think you're honestly 6 to 8 months before the decision can be made.
At least.
At least.
And one thing, I would hope that we would not abandon our standard road plan because of worries over cost, because it's going to be very difficult.
We don't print our own money.
It's going to be very difficult for us to go back and improve those after these are built.
What did you say, Clyde?
We don't print our own money. All the comment I made was that I can't, it's unrealistic to me to believe that it's a $2.1 million project out there for a two-lane road that can't be more than 600-700 yards long from where you want to run it to the improvement that's already existing. And I can understand, you know, you can build it and make it cost 2-point-something other million dollars. But I just don't think it's necessary.
Alderman Burke, then I've got Alderman Peterson.
I agree with what Clyde's been saying all along here tonight. And first of all, we need those funds. We need those resources. I think we should get them from the developer. I think we should get those funds and apply that. Personally, it's not just about cost, I wouldn't think, that Mike brought up. But why? Cost is one thing, of course. But it's not only cost that I'm going to make this suggestion, that we don't do curb and gutter in that area. And the reason for it is because we have to start not saying every time we annex in something or any time we bring something into the city that, okay, curb and gutter, always. We have to start looking at our character areas here. And we have to say, does curb and gutter actually belong here? When we were talking about the Del Webb project, one of the things I said, and I truly do believe, that Del Rio Pike in that area out there is our Natchez Trace of Franklin. And we have to be very careful to protect that area. And there's different areas around town that we need to look at in that vein. And we need to be very astute when we are going in there and doing our plans and looking at that. And I don't think curb and gutter belongs out there. I think it has to continue, even though people will build out there, we have to continue to give that rural feel to that area. And that transition period, once you get off 96, that's a great transition place to start that, to ease out to the country and into the county, into our urban growth boundary. So I, for one, don't want the curb and gutter. And of course, Clyde, that cut down on the cost as well. Also, you know, we need to probably cover our bases and do different things. And, you know, besides, you know, getting the funds from the developer, how about if we do a condition of approval would be that we have a plan of services added in the language there where the city would hire a third party maybe to do a traffic engineer study. I think we should do that, paid for by the developer. I think we should do that. That would be my recommendation, too.
Alderman Peterson.
Well, there are so many aspects to this, and many of you know that the city, not that many years ago, had included collectors in the road impact fees. However, it did not work very well and for many reasons. And so that was declined, you know, or changed to eliminate them. I think that needs to be considered as we go through all of this. However, many of the areas are out in situations where there's a county road already out there and it's not built to what we would think of as city standards. However, I do want to echo what is also said. You know, even the current stormwater regulations encourage swales, or what we all used to call ditches, you know. But, I mean, they're saying that is a more...
environmental friendly.
I see. Mr. Martin remembers them well, too. but at any rate, it might be more appropriate in some areas where things are being built on county roads. However, I suspect, though, that would not leave as much property to put as many houses on if you do that. But it is something to be considered. And also, it might fit into the existing situation out there. But again, thinking about requiring everyone to have to pay a road impact fee for collectors would be an enormous amount of money that would be added to the road impact fee, in my opinion. I haven't gone back to look at any of that, but it was substantial, as I recall. So there are a lot of aspects to this, and I think that's one reason that it's going to be important to look at it in many ways. But again, please keep in mind, you know, we did this at one point and realized that didn't work. That didn't work here. Not to say that it couldn't ever work, but it would be very difficult, I think. Again, I'm open to look at it.
Mr. Stuckey.
I just want to touch on a couple things in the conversation. It's a really important conversation, a good one, that our infrastructure matters. And we have a situation here where what's consistent with the land use plan doesn't match what the infrastructure will handle.
Good point. Mm-hmm.
And we can talk about how much infrastructure, but it doesn't quite fit. Mm-hmm. So we have this conflict, and we need to think about ways to deal with the conflict. Mm-hmm. And this will be repeated over and over again as we develop, especially in this area and some other areas that are less developed now. We all live through the experience of what McEwen used to be and what it is now and how it functions so much better now. And we don't want to recreate that situation in other places because we tried to jam in more development around a country road.
Right.
And so I just caution us to think about we have standards for a reason. Mm-hmm. And that deals with our infrastructure and how that matches what the development will ultimately require or want. And how many places are we going back now and looking at and saying, boy, it'd be great to put a sidewalk in there or a path in now, and we do it, and guess who has to end up doing it? The city. The city alone. And that's okay, but we can only do so much, and we look at mechanisms to get those accomplished with development. Impact fee is one methodology. It's not the only methodology. And so that, I think, is the thing we're struggling with, and the balance point that we're trying to look at is to get enough infrastructure in place that makes development work, but also how you appropriately share that cost burden.
Yes.
And so I guess that's what I'm trying to summarize, I think, what we're dealing with and why we wanted to highlight this tonight, because we will see this movie over and over again over the next several years as development continues, where there are collectors that are very important to make the roadway network work, but they don't fit into our existing framework, which not only involves payment, but also involves developers getting credit for what they do on those roads. Mm-hmm. So it kind of goes both ways, because right now they can't get credit if they do things that improve that infrastructure either. So I just wanted to offer that perspective as maybe kind of a summary of what I think we're hearing and what we're struggling with. And again, it's a plan that fits the land use plan. I don't think anybody's saying it doesn't.
No.
But it doesn't matter. The infrastructure is not there to support it.
And in fact, can we say that one, I believe, and I don't know this for sure, that one of the collectors that the city spent a great deal of money on was Del Rio Pike.
Yeah.
Which part?
Del Rio Pike.
Del Rio Pike.
Yes, some other part. Not this part of it, but
yeah.
Well, the development brings the issue. But the issue, the immediate issue, is the fact that there's probably not a more dangerous 500 or 600 yards of road in Franklin than that little stretch of road right there. My concern may very well be that we solve the problem as far as the overall, it's going to occur again and again and again. But I would like to see some, because we have discussed this Carlisle. We have discussed it numerous times. We had the lady come, Mrs. Carlisle, whatever.
The Carlisle.
Dorinda.
Dorinda. And didn't want to give up her right-of-way and this and that, and wanted us to run the road somewhere different. So the issue right now is twofold. It's yours as far as wanting to solve an ongoing problem. It's ours and mine that we've got a situation where there's a safety concern out there. I don't think any of you think that that's a fairly safe curve or two or three out there.
Well,
you can't see.
Carruthers had the curve, remember? The real bad curve.
And McEwen has terrible curves
so,
on it.
Yes, we have.
We built Carruthers.
That's what I'm saying. And one of the issues now. Because of
what I said was right now,
All right.
As it stands, where is there a more dangerous few hundred yards of road than that section of road? And that's all I've said. Yeah, Carruthers had a curve and had several of them.
What did we spend
on Carruthers? $14 million.
$17 million.
Yeah.
We're getting ready
to
spend.
We're not disagreeing. We're just saying that there are roads with curves and danger, perhaps to a certain extent, particularly with more added volume.
And that's a good question.
Volume.
What is the traffic volume out there now? You know, I don't even know. I'm just asking. Let's also
it's pretty significant,
that.
And in the peak hours.
Absolutely, because they're cut through. We don't have Matt Catcher yet.
Yes.
Yep.
Exactly.
Well, I think did the applicant want to make any comments? Joe, Greg, did y'all want to make a comment, or y'all just? In the sake of time, we have a pretty long agenda, so.
Yep.
No, and I'll just be brief. We appreciate Paul and Vernon working with us on this. They approached us to talk about the concern that they have regarding the roadway, the issues regarding funding collector roads. We get it. We understand that. We're looking for, and at least Joe is looking for, a fair, equitable solution to be able to move forward with the development plan. And we've discussed the consideration of the additional fee for the collector road and believe that that would be a fair and equitable solution in this particular instance. Sure.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Ready to move on?
Yeah. And this is right.
Item number 8, consideration ordinance 2015-52, and orders to rezone 21.31 acres into the height overlay district. The property is located within the Cool Springs East Subdivision 501 and 1000 Corporate Center Drive, lots 370 and 372, establishing a public hearing for November the 10th, 2015.
And I'm happy to answer any questions.
Everybody familiar with that property?
It's in the, yep.
Good. Okay, we'll move on to number 9 then. Consideration of ordinance 2015-53 to be entitled an ordinance to amend the zoning ordinance of the City of Franklin, Tennessee, Chapter 3, Section 3.3, Subsection 3.3.1, parentheses 3, pertaining to lot measurements, and amend Chapter 3, yada, 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 site development standards. those are development terms, if y'all didn't know. Site development standards for residential building types in conventional areas, and Table 3A entitled Site Development Standards. I don't know who writes these things.
One of these folks. Mayor, I did. I'll take it.
Yeah, go ahead and say that.
Certainly not a doctor.
Jim Sloboda. This is a text amendment to the zoning ordinance, essentially to establish minimum lot frontage requirements for new residential detached lots. We had to reference all the different tables in the ordinance that would be amended, but this will address the issue of flag lots and lots that are located off of access easements. The Planning Commission talked about this last month and recommended approval of it to you. I'm glad to go into any detail if you want or answer any questions.
Well, we were just looking also recently at a neighborhood meeting where this type of thing comes into play, and even though I think we really want to move in this direction, mm-hmm. Wouldn't you all agree? There's still some things that need to be looked at,
sure.
There, because it can be very complicated if it's, especially this is really directed in a lot of ways at infill, and that makes it more complicated, I think.
Okay, everybody ready to move forward?
Well, wait just a minute.
Okay.
All right, so what are we, are you changing the minimum lot size?
No, currently the zoning ordinance only requires a minimum lot width. Mm-hmm. It doesn't require that there be any specific lot frontage or street frontage. This establishes a minimum street frontage. Mm-hmm. In traditional areas, it ranges, it's at 80% of the lot width. In traditional areas, it would be 40 feet if you're on a street, or 30 feet off an alley. But lots that are on a cul-de-sac don't have to have a minimum lot frontage. They're exempt from that.
Okay, so you're talking mainly about flag lots?
Correct. Mm-hmm. Or lots, it just requires all new residential lots to have lot frontage, road frontage.
This is only for detached lots?
Detached.
Right?
Correct. And so if you have I forget the example
so
that we use.
So this will get rid of flag lots?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. I think that's the idea. Mm-hmm. Okay. Which is
the minimum frontage, which would get rid of that little strip.
Yeah, it can't. In other words, it can't be owned separately.
That's but only in these areas, or not necessarily?
It applies citywide. There's two different types of areas that where we do establish the standards. One's conventional areas, one's traditional areas. Conventional areas, it's a percentage of the lot required lot width. Uh-huh. In the traditional areas, which are like Central Franklin, downtown, it's either 40 feet or 30 feet.
So basically we're saying by changing this that you can't have any ancillary dwelling in the back of your home.
No.
This is for two lots.
This is just for the creation of a new lot. The lot has to have street frontage. Having additional dwelling.
I'm not going to say names, but examples of like where Evans Street created the backyards of people's homes. They sold them, but they created it so that it was facing Evans and not.
That had a frontage, so that would be okay.
Yes.
Got it. And we are dealing separately with the accessory dwelling unit.
That's another ordinance coming.
That's coming soon. That's a coming attraction.
Accessory dwelling.
Yeah,
okay.
Accessory dwelling units, which are the.
But again, whenever you put this in with some other areas, it can affect not just the lot that's being subdivided, but the existing homes that are all around that. Not just the one lot,
right.
To make it a flag lot or not. As I say, it has an effect on, if it's infill, it has an effect on all the other lots around it, and how it is located and is in position with respect to them.
I'm not sure I understand. That's
the reason I think there'll be something coming up that'll be an example of that. But that's not the only time, though. But I mean, it might fix that one particular lot that's being subdivided. But it won't. But if it affects all the other houses around it in a bad way,
how would it?
Alderman Bransford.
Okay, let's just say here in Franklin, you will have a lot with a trailer on it. Mm-hmm. And that lot may be less than 40 feet frontage. And the trailer goes away. Mm-hmm. So can a person on that 40, 39 feet lot build a home?
Yes. There would be an existing lot of record.
Okay,
exactly.
That's what I need
exactly.
to
mm-hmm.
That would be exempt. This is, we're talking about new lots that are created.
Okay.
Okay, everybody good?
Okay.
All right. We'll continue with the planning show here.
You look very nice.
Consideration resolution 2015-80 to be entitled resolution approving development plan for 231 public square PUD subdivision with one modification of standards, location of drive-through structure, located at 231 public square with the city of Franklin, Tennessee, established public hearing for November the 10th.
Yes, and this also has one modification of standards for the location of the drive-through that they'd like to put. And I can answer any questions you may have on this one.
This is what we think of as the first Tennessee version.
Yes.
Right.
Our neighbors
throw away.
They're doing a small addition to it.
They need that.
Right.
Yeah. That's smart.
Alderman Skinner.
In one of the presentations, they were showing to have access through our parking garage lane, is that still included in this plan?
It is.
Yes, we need access.
That they're going to use the drive in the back and loop around.
It's called interconnectivity.
Yeah.
Yes.
But there is a concern.
If they're trying to bring, let's say, a truck to unload a dumpster through here.
No, they've done their...
Is this going to be...
No, they're not going to.
Well, they've done their auto turn template for the fire trucks and for the dumpster. The dumpster won't be going through here, and the auto turn for the fire truck, I believe, has it going not through the parking garage, but sort of in between City Hall and the parking garage, and then looping through.
And Alderman Peterson has brought up before that that is a narrow access where you go into the temporary parking just behind City Hall.
Yes.
That it's difficult not, we're not intending this to be two-way traffic through there, are we?
Yes, we are.
That's the problem, if we're doing this.
Two ways. Yes, we've done the, our traffic engineers looked at it and then...
Is there adequate space for us to...
Carl's verified that, yes.
Well, the problem is if you're parked there and you want to back out, that's where the problem comes. Whereas if it were slanted or something, you know, you can back out pretty easily. But since it's at a 90-degree angle, it would be very difficult to back out if somebody's coming, if you're making it two-way.
Right.
You know, so that's something that we've talked about. It's
There's only place to go.
And the modification on the...
Drive-through location.
On the drive-through, it's primarily about how much stacking there is? Is that what we're doing?
No, it's about putting it internal to the block is what the zoning ordinance requires. And in this case, there's just really no internal space. You would have to essentially build a building in front of it or take off a section of First Tennessee Bank to get it internal. So what they've done is just pulled it slightly off the building. Planning thinks that it doesn't make any, I guess, detrimental effect to the streetscape than the awning does now, just to slightly pull it off. And it still does meet the queuing requirements. Yeah.
You want to show your exhibit?
Yeah.
Sorry to wake you up.
Brought it up.
Jason Goddard with Design Studio. Matt and I have been working with staff for several months on all of the parameters of the...
I can help Matt. It's fine. I'm sitting.
That's good. Of the site plan. The area in question, this is the access that goes between the parking deck and City Hall currently. Not sure why it's not showing on this exhibit, but you'll see it on the technical documents of our application. Engineering and fire are both encouraged by this connectivity and the additional access points that they have. The technical documents in the application actually show a diversion cutout in the curb that would limit the traffic coming southbound to continuing forward behind City Hall, but force them through the garage access and back out to Second Avenue.
So it would be one way.
Technically, you could go out, but there will be a little diversion curb.
Bump out.
It would be obvious. We're directing people the other way.
You want it to go through the garage.
It forces them back out, back to Second Avenue as quick as possible.
So if the city puts a sign up, says exit this
correct.
Way.
Correct. Okay. Yep.
I'm good.
And now you know that. Where you go through that, though, you know, it has a height restriction on it.
Right.
Is that okay? I just happen to think about it when you're talking about that.
Just put a height restriction on the ATM so that.
Is there any way to take out this is a little radical, but anyway, take out the curb on this side of City Hall?
That?
No, the curb on this side of City Hall over here. You know, where you walk into City Hall?
Yeah.
Where's your parking garage?
Right there. Here's parking garage.
And if we walk out of the parking garage and go into the back end of City Hall.
There's a sidewalk entry.
Yeah. That whole curb up and down there, you step up and we have a sidewalk. Can we move that towards City Hall more so we can have more space for driving?
Who land is
that?
City Hall.
Or sidewalk.
We're working on getting all the survey information for the City Hall, but we measured this in the field. I think we scaled it off at about
25 feet for that drive aisle there, which, you know, standard.
That's plenty.
Pretty ample.
I guess so, that would be.
It's pretty standard.
All right, okay.
Then the other thing is, what's going to happen whenever we build a new city hall? How's that road handled then?
Yeah.
Different.
I mean, well, if that's going to be the access to the drive-through,
right?
You know,
we have this lot working as it is without the cut-through, but the cut-through is encouraged for connectivity by fire and sanitation and planning, just where we're always looking for opportunities for connectivity, so that if something happens, right now the easiest, cleanest, quickest way is to come and go.
Right through there.
And we're not encouraging.
This is an alternative.
That's a good point. That's
just another connectivity.
It's just that there's another outlet in the event that
gotcha.
Something else is going on and they need to get there.
And people are going to use the easiest way in and out anyway.
It's
so
clearly
that's
the most obvious and the most visible.
Yeah, when it's obvious and
where they're going to come in and think to go back out.
Right. So the other thing is his ability to do. Currently, people park in here when they walk to Main Street. They're cutting across, kind of catty corner across the parking lot. Mm-hmm. This kind of reconfiguration of this intersection gives us the ability to bring the sidewalk around and then channelize folks with a crosswalk and then
to go through that,
to go down that pedestrian corridor.
It's much safer this way and along this edge of our building so that you're not walking through the drive aisle to get to Main Street or through the square.
And you do see a lot
of cut through there. So there will be sidewalk adjacent to your building?
Yeah, sidewalk along the back of the building here that brings people directly to Main Street, and then this crosswalk will take people down between the walk between City Hall and the
Okay.
So really
making it much more pedestrian friendly.
Yeah, that's good. And are we losing access or somewhat cut off our entrance to here to City Hall?
No.
You're not making the building out more than it was? Nope.
Mm-hmm. Well, it will come out a little further, but these are the existing stairs.
Okay.
In the City Hall.
We gave up a little bit of property on the...
I remember that. That's why I was trying to identify it.
Very small strip of property. So
okay.
All right, any other questions?
We did pull up the renderings on the screen just to show folks the change in the facade and the look of the building, which is pretty significant.
Absolutely.
What's the brick look like?
Quite significant.
Not black and white.
No. Got any other questions about it or anything?
That's
all right, good deal. Right. Number 11, consideration initiating the annexation process and draft plan of services resolution 2015-73 for the annexation of certain areas on Clovercroft Road, specifically 4150 Clovercroft Road, in the parcel immediately adjacent to the East Parish Presbyterian Church, establishing a public hearing for November the 10th, 2015. Brad, you got it?
I got it. Be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Alderman Berg.
I want to say up front, this is the church I attend. So, just to be transparent with that. And they're asking for ability to annex in to build a relatively small church out there, not large. And any other questions that I would be able to answer and let me know.
And again, this is what we've done and have a number of these kind of coming through the pipeline where you're giving us direction up front to enter into the more involved annexation, development plan, zoning process that's involved when we bring property into the city. So this is that initiation of the process, and we would have a public hearing on November 10th and accept that direction from the board at that time too.
I might mention one other thing. We currently own the little, used to be the wedding chapel. I don't know if you're all familiar with that. It's the very end of McKay's Mill. And we own that site, and to acquire the 10 acres next door will allow us to keep the building that we have now and use that for future as well and not be displaced while we're building. And it's right there at the very end of McKay's Mill. We've been very good neighbors with them. I don't think we've had any complaints or anything with them. And the sewer is right there. And eventually, I know they'll probably be doing road improvements over there and working with that as well, and turn lanes and the whole shebang. But I would just like to say that whole, I would love for us to look in to annexing in Clovercroft Road at some point. We have bits and pieces all the way from 96 to Wilson Pike, and it's like city, county, and then we have a long stretch in there, it's all city, and then it goes to county. And it sort of like makes no sense in that road. And we really do need to be looking at Clovercroft in the future, the entire road out there because of all the growth in that area. But that's just a sidebar.
Go ahead, Vice Mayor.
I'm sure that there's an explanation here. That says annex, plan of services, that says annexing 14.6 acres. But my purpose says 4.7.
That was a mistake that was caught. That is just a typo.
So it is 14.6.
That's correct. There's a one left out.
That includes the current church building, not just the land.
And the applicant is requesting this. I mean, owner.
Yeah. Well,
we're not forcing
that. We're hoping to.
But they all are.
Finish purchasing the land, but we need to go this step. Yes, right.
Number 12, presentation of land use plan amendment from McEwen Character Area Special Area 6 to add a neighborhood commercial node along Carruthers Parkway between Murfreesboro Road and Long Lane.
Thank you. This is informational only. Last month, the Planning Commission approved some language in the land use plan that would support neighborhood commercial along Carruthers Parkway. Let me know if you have any questions.
Okay. And we looked at that.
You may remember this if you went on the
field trip,
the mobile workshop. This is the area right by some of those residential areas that does really make a lot of sense to provide some services in a commercial node.
And Mrs. Peterson and Ms. Berger, when we do the mobile workshop with you, we'll show you what we're talking about.
The rest of us. Hey, we were out having fun.
We got the first aid kit for those.
At least I was on vacation.
You're going to have more fun.
I was at least on vacation. I don't know about you all.
Hey, we want to go again.
I'm not coming back from vacation to go home. Sorry. I do recall the mayor wasn't there.
Mayor.
Okay, that was
mayor. One thing I want us to be sensitive about, I know there's a node like this in McKay's Mill, and there were some issues that came up with business versus residential being adjacent. I would hope that we would require significant buffering between those areas and be sensitive to things like dumpster locations.
Oh.
Because there are some residential lots that are adjacent to some of the south area.
Well, can I make
do we not have guidelines for that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, for transitions.
And since that loading dock went in, we have changed the zoning ordinance on that. We've had different changes on that. I think the setback is deeper, whatever. But the problem there was, somebody, you know, they had the condos over there at Montgomery Place, and you walk into your living room with this big glass window, you got the loading dock in the back, and they're going to put up trees. And what the city required was this much, and what needed to be there was about this much as far as the intensity of landscaping. So working with the developer, with the public, the people that own the land out there, they came in, and with our meetings out there and everything, we got them to do about, you know, I don't know what the cost was, but a lot more, a significant amount of landscaping. And then that today is doing much better, but the noise is still there. Mm-hmm. So the noise is the issue, right, too, not be just the sight, the noise.
Yeah, that's true.
So look and see what we've got in there. I'm not sure.
Number 13, presentation of land use plan amendment to move the existing boundary between Central Franklin Character Area 4 and 6, located at 405 Eddy Lane.
Thank you. This is informational only as well. Last month, the Planning Commission approved a land use plan amendment for the parcel at 405 Eddy Lane. And speaking of screening and buffers, there is a significant incompatible use buffer between this parcel and the large data center.
And part of the emphasis for this plan amendment was to discourage the non-residential development on Eddy Lane, because, as you know, it's a narrow street that really should not handle industrial traffic. and going through in a residential neighborhood.
This is currently residential also.
It is.
The use there at the moment is residential.
Yes, there are three dwelling units on it now.
And there's frequently, I've seen trucks trying to turn off that lane.
Fall over.
Yeah, fall over right off 80 and 96.
Item 14, consider resolution 2015-82, a resolution to authorize staff to enter into contract negotiation with Barge, Wagner, Sumner, and Cannon for the preliminary engineering phase, environmental only for the Columbia Avenue widening project. Y'all look great tonight, by the way. Anybody got any questions about that one? Okay, we'll go to number 15. Consideration of amendment number 2 to the TDOT contract number 110291 for the Franklin ITS extension and adaptive signal control technology projects for time extension and redistribution of existing funds.
That title pretty much says it. We're adjusting the completion date of the grant and shifting some dollars, I think, to adaptive signal work. So that's basically what this provides for. And this has been budgeted over the last couple of years, and we'll extend that out another year.
Sounds good.
Okay, number 16, consideration of bid award to ESC Lab Sciences in Mount Juliet, Tennessee, in the total estimated amount of $39,964 per year for industrial pre-treatment, sampling and test, water reclamation facility, influent and effluent testing, and testing of river samples for the Water Reclamation Division of the Water Management Department. Questions about that? Number 17, draft consideration of draft agreement. Draft amendment number 2, the City of Franklin contract number 2013-0001, professional services agreement with CDM Smith for the Water Reclamation Facility Modification Expansion Project in the amount not to exceed $740,500.
So this amends our existing services agreement with CDM Smith for a number of items, a number of them related to the water reclamation or wastewater treatment plant itself, along with some additional permitting services and also the what's called the TMDL or total maximum daily load study that has been initiated recently with TDEC and the EPA. So that kind of wraps it all into one contract amendment, but those are several items, and Mark and David can speak to specifics on that if you like.
Alderman Martin.
Can you just, in 5 words or less, tell us
no.
the difference
that's between, between reclaimed water and water that we use for irrigation? I mean, is that the sewer plant?
This is a sewer plant, let's call it.
So the reclaimed water is water that has been treated through a wastewater plant. The only difference is there's the addition of chlorine at the end of the process, and that goes through the distribution system for use as irrigation.
And what do we call it?
Reclaimed
water.
I think there's a gray water.
Sometimes people call it gray water.
We call them both reclaimed water.
It is reclaimed water.
But we ought to call it the sewer plant. I mean, I'm sorry, sewer treatment plant.
She's talking about the water.
I understand what she's talking about on the other, but on the thing that is sewer treatment.
We talk about the sewer plant.
Yeah.
And reclaimed water goes through that, it's cleaned and put back out.
That's how you get reclaimed water.
Yes. Yeah.
But then some of the water is
discharged into the river.
Some is, and then other is saved for irrigation.
Exactly, right.
But you both, you named them both reclaimed water.
It's all reclaimed water.
You are reclaimed, even if it goes to the river.
There's a difference.
Well, what do you call it?
She's the nail.
Aren't you asking, is the same water they put in the river and the same water they use for landscaping both called reclaimed?
Yeah, well, that's what I just said.
Mark, just explain the difference.
Okay, so we refer to the plant, the wastewater treatment plant, is a water reclamation facility because we're reclaiming wastewater for use as irrigation or to discharge into the river. So
either
we
or.
Typically refer to the one that goes in the river as effluent water.
So it's
effluent.
Yes, ma'am. So
treated effluent.
Treated effluent, yes.
Okay. So and then the other you use like we use at West Haven.
to
correct that would exactly. We don't, well, we use a part of West Haven. Yes, that is reclaimed water. So that is water that has been put into a pipe, you know, the purple pipes, I think, has been referred to.
That's what we all want. We all want that to water our yards.
Y'all want that to water the yards. I think that would be wonderful, and the expansion of the reclaim system would be great. There's a lot of commitment and cost to it.
Exactly.
We'll be talking about that in coming months.
But
longer term.
Is everybody okay with the contract first?
Get
your back focused. I mean,
I've gone past.
How'd you come up with that question, Margaret?
No, but I know exactly what you're talking about. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
It should be called what it is, and because it sounds like they're the same thing.
I don't like that term.
Oh, we don't have to call it that. Right. That's just called the sewer treatment.
That's better than
sewer treatment. I mean, you might, that may be, but really.
Okay, we're going to move on then.
That's what it's called.
Item 18, consider a contract number 2015-0286 with Bridges for the Emergency Shelter Grant Program. Yes. Sub-recipient agreements for program year 2015-16 in the amount of $62,319.
Yes. Mr. Mayor, my wife serves on the board here, so I guess I will not be entering into the discussion.
You're right, there's not going to be a discussion.
Number 19 is consideration bid award to Truckers Lighthouse, Inc. of Nashville in a total lump sum of $76,711.90 for the aftermarket upfitting of 10 new police vehicles for the police department. Any questions about that one?
No.
If not, we'll move on to number 20, consideration resolution 2015-64, a resolution to adopt the police department community room policy and guidelines.
This is, the facility's getting a lot more use and a lot more demand, and we have a similar policy for this room in terms of how it's used. Mm-hmm. And we would just like to have a specific policy, as we have different types of groups and individuals approach us about the use of the facility, that gives us that guidance.
Yeah, sounds good.
Yeah. Okay. Alderman Skinner.
Mr. Mayor, I would, you all know that I'm part of the roundtable, Civil War roundtable, that probably uses this room more than anybody else on a regular basis. We would ask for two considerations on this. One would be, often when lecturers come and lecture on a particular subject, it's usually a book, that to benefit our citizens that would like to purchase a book from that lecturer, that transaction be allowed to happen. It's not like we're truly conducting a business there, but it's a benefit for our citizens that would like to have more information about the lecture that they have heard. The other thing I would ask, the notification of when that the room would be used by the city, I think it says without any notice. I would ask that, I think in here it says 5 days, if you're going to cancel, that you're going to use the meeting room. I think it would be appropriate for the city to also offer that group 5 days notice, so that you don't have 70 people showing up.
We may not always have that luxury.
I know.
Things other happen than that cause us to need to use the facility. So I think we would make every attempt to do that.
If there's an emergency, I realize, but I would hope that we could give people a little more notice than immediate. So I would ask that if staff could look at those two items.
Vice Mayor.
Any reason, Eric, that you know of, to have that room have a different policy than this room or the training room down there?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I think it's pretty similar.
Enough said.
Alderman Berger.
I agree with Mike, too, with the books and things of that nature, especially when we're having, I don't know how you would define those activities, but I think if somebody's coming and they have historic books and that nature, that they should be able to, you know, it's not like they're doing a business. This is not their business, but, you know, they do bring those materials from time to time, and I think some of that's fine.
And I think that's also common sometimes in the eastern flank.
When
that's used. So.
Can you not sell a book out there?
Well, if I want to buy a book.
I don't know
book.
What we've done with that.
But it's not connected to a lecturer.
No.
I think what we're trying to avoid is an outright fundraising or business purpose.
Yeah, right.
So I think this is a little more, it's more related to the fact that they're presenting to the public on a matter of interest. And so I think we can look at how we do that, that it's still related to the broader purpose of what's going on as opposed to being turned into a
silent auction.
Something that's more of a straight up fundraiser or business venture.
Something more educational.
I think there's a way to work with that.
Yeah, I think it has to be in the education.
Alderman Blaine.
I'm just going to draw the Union We Go speaker series here as a tree commission, and I feel quite certain those people have products that they peddle. At the end of that.
Make available.
Make available. You're so much better with words than me.
Okay, we're moving along pretty good here. Let's go to discussion regarding police department body cameras.
Wanted to just give you all an update and give Chief and our team from the police department and city attorney an opportunity to share with you where we are. This is an item that was included in our adopted budget to fund the purchase and deployment of body cameras for our police officers, also a position to support the management of that data. And our staff has been working diligently on looking at how we develop policies to monitor how we use the technology and really do it in a way that does it right, is appropriate in terms of our relationship with our citizens. And want to share with you where we are in that process and highlight some of the issues we're working through as we work towards implementation. I'll let Chief and her team go from there.
Thank you. Good evening, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you about this. We have been very diligent on this. We had our guidelines. We had our directive to get started on this. And some of the things I want to talk about very quickly, because I know you have a tight agenda. We want to talk about what we've accomplished so far, where we're headed, and what some of the obstacles are, or at least issues we'd like you to consider as we move through this implementation. With me are some staff members that you may or may not know, but for that benefit, I want to make sure you do know. Lieutenant Scott Butler, who is over our professional standards and accreditation. Lieutenant Charles Warner, who is over public affairs, and I think you know Shauna Billingsley, who's with our legal department here at the city. First of all, what we've accomplished so far during this time period of the first quarter of the new fiscal year, just to set the stage, really, for I think everybody knows, I think you've seen things on television about what a body-worn camera is by a police officer, but simply this, it is a mobile camera that records audio and video between police officers and the public. The police department is really no stranger to video. We've had dash cameras in our police cruisers for about 15 years, believe it or not. It's been that long. Just about all of our marked vehicles have them now. We have upgraded as a result of our budget this year, and all of our police marked vehicles will be good to go with this latest technology by the end of next week. So we have accomplished that. Another addition that we've done is that we have given every police officer a pocket tape recorder, and it's really handy. It is easier to activate. It has a really good range. In fact, the officer doesn't have to take it out of their pocket and set it. They just hit it like that. It's got a big button on it, and it records conversation. We have reviewed and evaluated model policies from the International Association of Chiefs of Police, law enforcement agencies across the state of Tennessee and across this country. We've incorporated our accreditation standards that include issues regarding digital records, and we've reviewed best practices from law enforcement agencies, not only in Tennessee, but also, again, across the nation and even in the United Kingdom. We have developed a policy, and we've reviewed it with consultants from UT MTAS, also a Tennessee open records law expert, and our city attorneys. I've attended patrol roll calls to talk about this, various community meetings, Alderman Peterson was at one recently. Also, our Citizens Police Academy, which is a great venue to talk about things like this, and our Citizens Government Academy, the current class. We've conducted a preliminary review of the current technology in order to start the process of looking at the bid and the purchase process. We want to develop our specifications, what our needs are here at the City of Franklin. I've consolidated our property and evidence function of the department in order to combine all digital records. Hopefully, what we'll do is, and our goal, is to enhance program integrity and evidence management. Now, going forward, this is a hot topic, and it is a big one. There are challenges. Anytime you introduce something like this, a body-worn camera, it has to be done right with measures in place to ensure its success. Now, here are some key concerns that I have, and I've talked to other chiefs of police, and they feel the same way. First of all, privacy, something that we all cherish. It's imperative to balance privacy considerations with the need for transparency in police operations. We go into the homes of our citizens every day, and everything we see will be recorded by this camera. People call us when they are having the worst day of their life, in many cases. It could be a domestic violence call, a sexual assault, a medical call, a suicide attempt, child abuse, a robbery, a theft, all of this captured on video. Now, right now, the first thing that happens when a crime occurs in the City of Franklin is that either I or Charlie, Lieutenant Warner, gets a call from the media about the crime, and they ask for two things: any video that you have and the 911 call tape. That's automatic. Now, I'll tell you that I have spent my entire career protecting and advocating for crime victims. This part of a body-worn camera policy deeply concerns me. The public records law in the state of Tennessee that we have, it's no secret, is very lenient and very liberal. It is what it is, and we understand that. What I want to ensure is simply this: we follow the law, but we're mindful of this as we move forward. With dash cameras, there really is no expectation of privacy. You're out in the middle of the street in front of a police cruiser that's got blue lights on and flashers, and you know everybody in the world's watching you, and there's lots of witnesses. No real expectation of privacy. But when you're inside a home, you're in a hospital or a medical facility, that's different to me, and I think it is to you too. Now, another issue is retention. Whenever you have property and evidence, you always have to have a retention schedule. Maintaining, logging, managing, storing hours of footage will require considerable labor and data storage. It all mounts up quickly. Officer discretion is another issue that I have concerns about. I need to allow my officers to have some discretion on these calls. We have, and I don't think I have to tell you this, I think you know it, we have an excellent police department. My officers are smart, and more importantly, they care deeply about the people that they serve. I worry about the citizen that wants to come up to an officer and talk to them, but they don't want to be recorded. Trust is key in this profession. Without it, we can't be successful. We're working hard to build community trust. We know so many agencies across this country who don't have that. We don't want to lose it. And also, I'll tell you from a personal perspective, I need the trust of my officers. I want them and I need them to trust me, and I never want to lose that. Now, officer safety is another important point here. I never want an officer to hesitate to react to danger quickly. Their focus has to be on potential threat and not whether or not they've remembered to turn on their camera or not. And I've seen some officers in some places where they have, oh my God, I'll get fired, I better turn my camera on, and they almost had a very serious situation happen. Now, going forward, After telling you all of that, we are hopeful that the state legislature will craft some protections limiting public access, and before the media gets their hair on fire. I'm not saying anything in particular, except that as it relates to body camera footage, particularly when it has sensitive content, when we look at witnesses and the innocents in the background, whether it's children, whether it's the elderly, whether it's anyone who is just an innocent who happens to be there. I believe that body cameras will eventually become a basic piece of law enforcement equipment. However, we need guidance from the legislature to protect the public and our officers. Currently, there is no case law on body-worn cameras. And get this, the first agencies who implement body-worn cameras will create case law, and I'd love to avoid that. I want to reassure you, each one of you, the mayor and the members of this board, that we have been and we will continue to work very hard towards this implementation. It's important to this city, and we get that. It's important to our department. But more important is that we are mindful of the people that we serve, and I gotta keep saying, and my police officers. And that's what I have to say about this. That's where we are, that's where we're headed, and these are the bumps in the road that we're working with in order to do it right. We want to get it right.
I think our focus from the beginning has been on getting it right, not just getting them out there as soon as possible. Yeah. And we wanted to share this with you tonight so you see the depth of this issue. It's not easy. And so we want to provide that protection to our officers, to our public. We all get why it's important, but we also see the other implications in terms of the relationship and what I would call the inability to provide just some common sense privacy protections. I mean, there are things that we can all think of, and Chief sort of listed the incidents that an officer might run into that you would expect our ability to maybe, you know, blur a face or limit what goes on or goes off in that situation. But we don't have that as the law is written today. So if we can get some support from you all to work with our legislators to talk about this and to see what we can come up with. One of the examples came up, the state of Florida has a very similar open records law as Tennessee does, and they've made some legislative changes in the last year or so to address some of these very issues. So if you're comfortable with us taking a little more of a role of advocacy in that area and working with legislators, yeah, this is just, as you dive into this deeper, you see the potential issues here, and that's what we wanted to bring to you tonight, to say we're working hard on it, we're making progress. We think half the state is waiting for us to issue a policy because they want to work off of it because they know how hard we're working on it, and how much we've brought in different expertise to help us understand the implications. But again, we want to get it right, and some of that involves getting some help in how the law addresses this, because it didn't anticipate this type of document being created.
Okay, so what do we need legislation to address? A ton of things. I mean, we're not talking about just like one thing here. For example, if we decided to blur someone's face, do we need legislation to tell us we can do that?
Yes.
We do. Okay. So those are the types of things we're looking at to go to the legislature for. Okay, which I'm sure you've got a whole list to ask. All right. The other thing would be when and where and how are the videos available to release to the news media or the public? Does that also have to be addressed in legislation?
Some of it's already addressed, I would say, but if it's an ongoing criminal investigation, we have issues that protect that information. It's the other stuff that we don't know. How long do we hold on to it? And it may be used for different things. Some of it might be criminal evidence. Maybe some is employment related that we would want to look at. And at the same time, you're going to have to have someone watch these videos as they come in every day. Someone's going to have to do that.
Now, would you have to do that Why would you have to do that every day unless there was an issue?
Well, if it's you and a citizen, or you, how would you know if there's an issue if someone's not watching the video?
So we're looking for trouble? I mean, we're looking I don't know not if we're for looking, issues?
What we're looking for is how long should we retain it?
Okay.
Because every video really is going to have a retention time. So you may work an 8-hour shift or a 10-hour shift. This section of your video for sure is criminal evidence. You worked a crime scene. You worked a crash. Yeah. Yeah. So now we're going to have to take that out of your video stream, somehow redact that out. We got to keep this part.
Yeah.
This next part, as we watch it, probably don't need to keep that. But where do you slice it and dice it?
Okay.
So someone's going to have to. Somebody's going to have to be editing these videos as they come in.
So somebody has the body camera. It's not turned on all the time.
No.
Only when there's an incident, so you have that. Okay.
It really goes on when you have a public interaction. The way we're looking at it.
Yeah.
Right.
That would make
when you
sense,
interact with the public, it's pretty much on. What we like is some guidance that allows that tells us when it might go off or when it's created, how we redact certain images or certain parts of people's identity or other things that might be important to a victim of crime, children, those sorts of things. What privacy protection can we afford them? Right now, we can't guarantee anybody any privacy protection.
And it's like tossing balls in the air, because if you decide to turn it off, you can't predict what might happen, so then...
Or what someone might say about why you turned it off.
Right.
So what are you protecting if you turn it off?
I mean...
The other thing with the retention piece has real cost implications, because we have to store this stuff.
Yeah.
So if we're having to restore, you know, all these, whatever, terabytes of video for 2 years, that's a huge amount of storage, a huge amount of cost, huge amount of management. Now, if we can cycle out stuff... after 30 days that has no criminal case, no claim of misconduct, nothing that is out of the ordinary, if we can take that stuff and delete it and move on, great. We need that kind of help and guidance that we can do some things to manage the record, if you will.
And obviously, you're going to see what other people have done, even though it sounds like we're going to be one of the leaders in this, but still, obviously, there's
every
been some
week,
experience.
Every week, I get a request for our policy, what's Franklin doing? Because they realize that we're progressive department. We are a very professional department. We're very mindful of legal issues, but more importantly, of our community. And so they would like to replicate what we do. And that's a compliment, but it's also a lot of pressure because, you know, we're not ready for prime time yet.
And we've seen some policies that have like that 30-day cycle out, but they're under different state laws. I mean, they don't have the same public records laws we do. And so that's what we need to get some help on.
It's a different
issue. So I just have one little comment about, okay, you maybe to look into this as you're moving forward with this, or to believe that we need further review. Who will be that person to review? I mean, what criteria that you review and you say, this is not important, this is?
Well, we do have a position that was in the budget as a technician to handle and manage all of this. However, it's going to take probably our legal guidance to look at that.
Right, I was talking about the character of the person, because if you're not that, you know,
well, that's why we need more guidance on what's allowed and not allowed, so we can apply it to those situations and come up with really an operating procedure around that as well.
Yep.
Well, let me have Chief highlight one thing organizationally that she's done, I think, in terms of how that is going to be put in the police department organization.
Right. In working with UTM TAS and a couple of our consultants, they had looked at just our criminal investigations and particularly property and evidence and said, you know, you really ought to pull property and evidence out of CID and have it sort of autonomous. And the more I thought about that, the more it made sense, because what I've done is I've placed it under, and Charlie's loving it, I've got it under public affairs, because I had already decided that I was going to be really up close and personal with this body camera issue, as I think I should be as the CEO of the police department. But so if we've got the body camera digital records coming in, it only makes sense to combine that with property and evidence, because that's where the tape recorder evidence is coming in. It's where the dash camera evidence is coming in. So particularly if Lieutenant Butler gets a complaint, which he looks at our internal complaints, he can overlay all of those to see what happens, even though it's two-dimensional, the body camera, the dash camera, and the he's already doing it with the tape recorders. We had an officer exonerated the other day on a complaint where they said that he was rude, and all he did was listen to that and said, no, you were. So it turned out it worked to the officer's advantage to have that tape recorder. So we've combined it. I think that will allow for much more program integrity to have all of that together. And in managing it and cataloging it, it's going to be an awesome task. It's a challenge, I have to say, and it's exciting in that respect. But I also think we need the parameters and the guidelines to do what I've just outlined for you tonight. Now, I've seen a couple of agencies across the state of Tennessee that are just putting them out there in the field. In fact, different brands, some, you know, one brand and another, without a policy and procedure. And I would never put our officers out there using something that is so technical and so personal and so invasive without some kind of guidelines of where you end up in the weeds and where you aren't in the weeds. So I think that's important, and I don't understand agencies to do that. I'd never do that to our officers or to our city.
Pauline and Martin.
My number one concern is the safety of our police officers. And with all of the things that have been happening lately and all of the accusations that have been made, I would love to have something to protect them and show the public how wonderful you are, and we appreciate it. Now, this morning, I had two police officers come into my home, and I'm glad
they didn't have a camera
because I had on my pajamas.
That's the point.
Had a sight.
We want to save that one for 3 years.
but I do want you to be safe, all of you, and that's my number one concern. And you know, if the rest of us are doing things we're not supposed to be doing, then maybe we need to be on camera.
Last comment, and then we're going to stop and get ready for the next meeting.
So, Chief, do we need this change in the state legislature before we initiate our program?
I think we're in agreement that we do need them to consider this and set some standards across the state so that we're all standardized, we all know what to anticipate, what the rules of engagement are, and the citizens know that as well.
Yep.
What I would request is that you give us this guidance, or you know where we're going, and that we sort of work on parallel tracks. Chief and her team continue to work on the implementation and the understanding the technology and what might be the right thing for us. But also we work with the state to get some better guidance and privacy protections in certain key areas as we look at implementation. As we get more ready to implement, we'll see where we are with that guidance and probably come back with some more update there. But we don't know how they'll sync up. But kind of if we can work on both of those, if everybody's okay with us taking that approach, that's what we'll move forward with.
Okay, great presentation.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks for bringing that job, too.
And, you know, we've got a meeting. You may want to come to a meeting.